Living lovely.
I'm Laura Forrest.
And I'm Riley Underwood. Today we have an extra special show that will take you down memory lane.
Not only will we see how much some of you seniors have changed, but how much Wolfbite has changed.
Stay tuned to see stories from the past years.
Let's start by throwing it back to a trend from 2015.
There is a new trend that's rolling through the nation.
They're pretty fun. They're kind of useless, but they look pretty cool sometimes.
They're stupid. They have wheels. They're not hovering. It's false advertising.
But with all the videos of people getting hurt on hoverboards, how hard is it to learn to ride one?
Mostly it's just like when you get on, you start like stop and go really fast. But then after that, you can pretty much like smooth it out and it'll be a lot easier.
With them being easy to learn makes it available for all ages, but do they really serve any purpose?
My brother and his girlfriend both have hoverboards and they like to go on little dates where they like hoverboard next to each other and their hoverboards died and I had to go and get them. I had to drive like 20 minutes because they were stranded. So I can understand buying the $300 ones online you can find, but $1,000 is just stupid.
They're really expensive and you can just like walk. They're really fun, but they're just useless, but they're cool.
With prices varying $200 to $1,500, it's still up to you, the consumer, whether or not you want to buy it.
When you hear it beeping because it's dying, don't continue to go 10 miles per hour. You will hurt yourself.
So whether you love them or you hate them, hoverboards are guaranteed to make you not bored. Reporting for Wolfbite TV, this has been Jack Widener and Tara Dorsch.
Man, I was only in sixth grade when hoverboards were popular. It seems like it was just yesterday.
It's crazy how time flies. It just goes to show how much trends change over time.
You know what else has changed over time? Pep rallies. The spirit has grown and people are more excited than ever to win.
Mm-hmm. However, one thing hasn't changed. The feud between the juniors and seniors. They have been rivals since the beginning.
You can feel it in their hands, hear it in their chants, and see it in their eyes. The senior class is desperate for a class competition win. The juniors have won the last three spirit competitions and have prepared all week while hungry for their four-peat title against the seniors.
I think they're all talking. Being louder is just in general, just scream. Like, I honestly think by the end of this year I will pass out an assembly because I scream so loud.
But the senior class has built up the momentum and fury over the course of three assemblies to take on the junior class with even more spirit each time. And their biggest ally, confidence.
They are definitely gonna come and seek revenge this time, and hopefully that no matter what happens, that will just be the loudest and there won't have to be a feud any longer.
I think that the seniors are gonna win because it's like, I guess it means more to them because it's like actually their last year as like being able to be in high school and everything.
As the assembly kicked off with the national anthem and rules for the day, the tension filled the gym. After several minutes of suspenseful games, the class chant competition that everybody has been waiting for began. With signs and spirit held high, the juniors came out strong and loud. And just when the seniors thought all hope was lost, the freshman and sophomore class bolts to the senior side to cheer against the juniors. With the force of a few hundred students cheering alongside the seniors, fear struck the junior class. When decision time came, the fate landed in the hands of...
juniors!
So, Timberwolves, will the seniors ever really win? Will the juniors keep their five-peat streak going? Let's find out at the next assembly. Reporting from Wolfbyte TV, this has been Riley Swickard, Sarah Stoweskelson, and Lauren Dremel.
I wonder who's going to win the spirit competition this quarter.
I'm not sure, but my bet's on the freshmen.
That's a bit of a bold choice, Riley.
Whatever. Let's talk about a different type of competition, or should I say a game.
The Middle Ages may have been hundreds of years ago, but for a community of people in Kansas City and nationwide, reenacting the past is a part of their present-day lives.
So I was looking for something else to fill my time with, and I went online, started searching for are there LARPs in the area, and I came across Centerpoint.
Kansas City has a thriving LARP scene. I set up the contracts and actually got this group here in Kansas City started. I've been kind of hooked ever since.
LARP is a type of live-action roleplay or battle that mimics past times or even fantasy worlds. Although it has acquired rising popularity among people of all backgrounds, many people may still not realize that it isn't all what it seems in the movies.
People look at it like it's this nerdy thing that you know, I would never do it, but I was a high school football player. And I love it. It's got a place for everybody, whether you want to do blacksmithing, leatherworking. There's always something in Ampguard for somebody to do.
The role play side of it, and you see it in some movies on TV where it's all the play acting. Well, it's a little bit different on the stick side of it, where guys are actually very competitive. They put time in just like a normal sport. It's kind of a side part. There's no role playing. It's straight, once you pick up a stick, who's the best fighter?
And for some LARPers, this hobby becomes much more than just a weekend activity.
Tiers where basically you get an Order of the Warrior based on how well you do, and once you get 10, you get a Warlord status, which is basically the best of the best in the country are Warlords, and that's what a lot of the fighters are trying to achieve.
That's it for people to step out of their skin, step out of the everyday normal life that they have to live, and become somebody new. Get to be somebody that you want to be, instead of somebody you have to be.
No matter how one decides to participate in LARPing, it always offers an escape from reality and a chance to reenact the past. Or in these LARPers' case, a whole new fantasy. Reporting for Wolfbyte TV, this has been Alex Hayden and Quinlan LaFont.
Wow, I've never seen anything like that before.
Me neither. Maybe you should try LARPing, Riley.
Maybe another time.
On the topic of things a little out of the ordinary, a senior here at Southwest has a very special pet.
What are all your goats' names?
Their names are Button, Cookie, Socks, Moo Moo, Nectarine, and Bambi.
When you think of household pets, dogs and cats come to mind. But for this family, they took having animals at home a little further.
Well, it wasn't really a decision. Our neighbor called and their goat had delivered triplets.
And there was a runt that the mom started to reject. Knowing the huge animal people we are, he called us and asked if we would be willing to raise this baby goat, and we were very willing.
It may seem crazy, but for the Gregorys, it was easier than expected.
At first, it was really different having a goat. It's a lot easier. They just kind of hang out, do their own thing, and they're pretty low maintenance.
Easy, fun, and energetic. There are many advantages to having goats at home.
There's so many perks to having goats. They're just so funny. They're lovable. Button, she's my favorite. The second you walk outside, she's begging for attention and always jumping all over us.
After adding chickens, swans, and more goats, this family doesn't plan on stopping their growth anytime soon.
I don't know, my husband swears he wants a turkey next. He also wants a teddy bear cow, so.
A lot of people ask why we keep getting more, but I think it's kind of become an addiction.
This growing home can remind us that families come in all different shapes, sizes, and furs. Reporting for Wolfbyte TV, this has been Brady Sorbin and Crandall Blake.
I wish I had a bond with my pets just as strong as Bethy does with hers.
You know who else has a strong bond? Carlin Blake and her sister Crandall.
She was very interested around 3 years old when her big sister was playing soccer.
Every day since she was a little kid, she would make me play soccer with her nonstop. It was just always soccer, soccer, soccer for her.
From a young age, soccer meant everything to Carlin Blake. But growing up in Wichita, Kansas led to the outgrowth of the skill and competition level.
I played on two teams. I played my age and an age group older because the competition in Wichita wasn't like near the competition in Kansas City.
Carlin's soccer in Wichita was really good for a foundation.
Throughout the years, as Carlin grew in her soccer skills and started to travel to play, the Blakes had talked about picking up their lives in Wichita and moving to Overland Park.
But I never thought it was actually going to happen. Even though I was up here every weekend, I didn't know how it was going to be when I lived up here.
The potential to move brought up many elements for the Blakes to consider.
It's all about the entire family and not just Carlin. We had to consider Carlin's older sister, Crandall, and what would be the best for her.
At first, I was really angry and I was disappointed that we had to move, but now it's probably one of the best decisions my family's made in our entire lives because now I'm spending time in Kansas City doing things I never thought I'd be able to do and just actually enjoying my teenage years.
Crandall is happier being in Kansas City along with the entire family.
Sometimes I was a little jealous. Why didn't I get a little slice of talent? But I'm not mad about it. And if you had to ask me right now, would you move to California or Antarctica or anything for Carlin to play soccer, would you move again? I would say yes.
Reporting for Wolfbite TV, this has been Evie Peterson and Grace Davis.
Just because Carlin moved to find her passion doesn't mean Crandall couldn't find hers.
Crandall has produced many stories on Wolfbite, one of them being the power of essential oils.
As you age, poor health is to be expected, but some have found a way to be as healthy as ever without the medication.
Let's see, I was diabetic, so I had high sugar. I was high cholesterol. I had high blood pressure. I got tired of taking pills because I'm an old guy. And so I found out that if I used these oils, I could get rid of my medicine.
If right now, if you came to me and you said you needed Advil, or if you needed some Tylenol, or you just needed some sort of salve on your finger because you cut it, I would not have that in my house. I have oils. That's what I use. It is my pharmacy.
Essential oils are sweeping the nation in the form of pills, diffusers, and topicals. But they aren't anything new.
Essential oils are, well, they've been around forever. There are essential oils in trees. There are essential oils in flowers. Certain plants, you distill them or whatnot, and then the little things that come out, that's the oil.
For one Southwest mom, essential oils were able to give relief in a way modern medicine would not.
I burnt my arm, and I ended up getting a staph infection from it. Well, I started using it, and within 12 hours, you could see a difference. Within 36 hours, my arm was totally healing incredibly well. I'd shown the doctor that I work with my arm, and he's like, you need to go get on antibiotics. And so the next day, he called me. He said, did you get on antibiotics? And I went, no, but there's no side effects with essential oils. You don't have to take something else to counter the oils.
Essential oils may be quick and easy, but for Steve and Linda Weber, they left a long-lasting impact on their lives.
Who wouldn't want to get off all their medicines? And who wouldn't want to be healthy? Who wouldn't be able to run 2 miles and do push-ups and sit-ups, you know, like you used to when you were young? I can pass the military physical again. I've been in the military for over 50 years.
Every moment of my life, it impacts me. We've been married almost 50 years. I cannot imagine a day without him. Just watching him get younger and watching him feel good, the things that he can do, it's a miracle.
It's crazy to see how much a little thing like essential oils can make a huge impact on your life.
I agree. Senior Paige Emery also had something you may not know about her that impacts her life every day.
Callie.
Paige was full-term baby. We had no idea that there was anything wrong with her, and I was
aware enough to know that when the nurses started scrambling as soon as she was born that something was probably wrong?
So basically when I was born with transposition of the great arteries. So my aorta and pulmonary valve were switched. So I came out not breathing.
She was literally blue. She had a purplish blue line from her chest up. And they had a cardiologist come in and tell us that she needed to have surgery.
They transferred me down to Children's Mercy and they did a balloon cath. So basically they cut a hole like in my leg and went in from down there and basically inflated a balloon in my heart that allowed the blood to flow because it wasn't flowing. And then when I was 6 days old, I had my big open heart surgery. My early childhood, I did really well. From the surgery, my aortic valve was leaking. So they put me on a blood pressure medicine in 2009 that would hopefully slow that leakage down. Did great for a while and then kind of just noticed I wasn't always feeling great. I had had like some chest pains here and there and like palpitations, which is basically just where you feel your heart not beating correctly. I was in a softball practice sophomore year and we were inside in the gym and we were running suicides back and forth, and I just remember my back was to the wall of the gym with the Timberwolf eyes. I started looking around and those eyes were at the other side of the gym where I was looking, and I was like, okay, something's like going on, and my world just started turning. And I called my mom and basically kind of burst into tears because I had no idea like what was happening. My heart rate was probably like between 175 to 200 for about an hour, and it just like would not stop. And she wanted to take me to the hospital and I kind of refused because I had, you know, something that was so new and just so scary at the time that I didn't want to know what was going on, but we knew something wasn't right. So that's when I started going back to my cardiologist because I usually only went every 6 months. And starting about April, I started going almost every month, if not every couple weeks for a while. I was put on a heart monitor and walked into school with kind of looking like a robot almost. So I had all these like wires underneath me and no one knew about it. It's never been something I've really shared or like told people. And it was just kind of hiding that, and I wore that for about a week and things just kept happening. And it was like, I'd walk up the stairs at school and my heart rate would go to 150 in like 2 seconds. And it was like things that would make me catch my breath or not be able to, you know, walk and like have a normal conversation. It was like, I feel like I just ran a marathon. They really couldn't figure out what was going on, so I went and got a second opinion. So he then diagnosed me with SVT, which is like sanventricular tachycardia is like how you say it. So basically my heart just goes into these super fast rhythms, and my heart, you know, you have your first heartbeat and then the bottom one that follows, and they weren't in sync. And he figured out, you know, I kind of had some like thyroid problems that was making me like super tired and my body not, you know, being super energetic. So he put me on like two or three new medicines and kind of instantly started feeling like a new person. I had like my energy back, and it was definitely hard though because I could feel my body like responding to the medicine. It kind of put me in really bad moods and like sad moods at times, and I'd never experienced that. It was like I had to turn the switch of like, I have to fight this. Like I've always been pretty happy, like energetic person.
She's just kind of continued to be a fighter since the day she was born and has done very well for the most part, and she's had some struggles along the way, but there's a lot of situations where her dad and I's heart breaks for her to have something wrong, but we feel very fortunate too because there are a lot worse things that could be wrong, and Paige has a great attitude about it and it doesn't slow her down.
You know, having something in your life that makes you wonder how many days you have left makes you appreciate life on a whole nother aspect. I've always, you know, kind of struggled with it, but I've understood now that I think God gave me, you know, the term for my, when I was born, it was like broken heart. And he gave me the broken heart because he wanted to mend it into something that was 10 times better, I feel like. Because there's so many aspects of my life that I feel like I could have, you know, been totally broken down or made it 10 times worse and be in a jillion pieces from it. But I feel like I've been built up by everything that I've gone through, and you have no idea what someone's going through, and you don't. And I know I'm not the only one who hasn't sat there for 17 or 18 years of their life and not told anyone about like what's actually going on. I just want people to understand like you are loved and you have people that surround you, and especially at Southwest, I've never met a more amazing group of people, and I feel so blessed to have like the community in my life.
Drive it. have your...
Thanks for taking this trip down memory lane with us.
See you later, T-Wolves. Don't forget to follow us on our social medias.